Alright, guys, so I did a live audio recording of a leak with my new 4-color money tribal deck here that you see right now. But unfortunately, the voice quality was not as good as I wanted it to be. And making a voice over, I don't have the time for this in its entirety right now. So I tried to pick out the last match, which was against Eldrazi Tron, because this shows mostly the highlight of what Omnath can do. And it was also the most fun and the most grind. And yeah, well, 28 lands with some red sources sprinkled in, as well as Renin 6 and Omnath now in the deck. Simply because yeah, all of those cards have a pretty nice synergy with each other. So Renin 6 nets us back fetch lands from the graveyard, sometimes triumphs if we can cycle one, and then it's also card advantage, but mostly fetch lands, which help with Field of the Dead and which help in triggering two landfall triggers with Omnath. And yeah, I mean, triggering Omnath twice means that he nets us red, green, blue, and white mana. And this can be used to, for example, follow up with a Teferi Time Reveler. I have used this to follow up with a Jace the Mind Sculptor. But you can also follow up this with Uro. Then maybe Uro drops another land into play. So you trigger landfall again for the last ability, which can deal 4 damage to each planeswalker of your opponent and the opponent itself. It plays around Leyland of Sanctity, it plays around Ensnaring Bridge. You don't have to attack, you just burn your opponent out, kind of, with that. And since Renin 6 can always give you back these fetch lands that you can bring in with Uro again, and then you fetch out, right? Everything triggers, landfall matters, and this is kind of the synergy of this deck. It's pretty powerful, in my opinion. And yeah, the flaw of Omnath is, well, it draws a card, and the opponent has to deal with it, so. That's a pretty good card for 4 mana. And Hour of Promise is also kind of playing the role in bringing out more land drops for your big baddies here. Yeah, the downside is 28 lands. Well, we will flood out eventually, and you will see that in a hot minute. And in the sideboard, the biggest new card is Cleansing Wildfire. And yeah, destroy target land, and down there, after the dot, you can read draw a card. So a 2-mana sorcery land destruction spell with draw a card. Sure, they get a basic, but if you want to fight against Tron or Amulet Titan, I think this card is good enough. And I choose to play this over Ceremonious Rejection because I wanted to try it out. And here, let's jump into the last match.
You heard what she said.
The league went 4-1. I won against this weird Sultai deck here. You can see a little snippet out of there. I will maybe make a voice over of the entire league, but right now I simply don't have the time. And yeah, the last match that I want to show you is against Eldrazi Tron. So we are on the play. And we have a turn to Renin 6. Two forces. I mean, this is, of course, still a keep against an unknown opponent. And yeah, Ren and Path to Exile would help against Ethereal decks, whereas the rest is probably good against anything else. So here we go. Renin 6 can also pick up the fetch land again so that our mana is perfect. And here we have a Field of Ruin against Tron deck, so we can pick over Field of Ruin all the time, and hopefully it's big Tron, so we can screw them over with that. So far, I don't know what they are playing, but let's start with Field of Ruin here. Now there's an interesting decision in grabbing more blue or green sources for Uro, or grabbing a basic path here in case you put them on Eldrazi Tron. I choose to go for the blue source because I want to work towards Mystic Sanctuary while blowing up their lands for the later stages of the game. But yeah, now I see that they have grabbed a waste, and here they go with a Warping Well, which can create 1 mana, and Now they can drop an Thought-Knot Seer that I can't path to exile, and since the path to exile will be exiled, there is no way in grabbing it back. So that was maybe a misplay, but I don't want to grab two early white sources against Big Tron, so it was mostly a gamble, and now we get punished for it. Having the Wrenn on the battlefield means that the single Lightning Bolt in my deck can at least kill it if we draw it now. And now we have the decision to make if we want to play Uru here or just blow up another land. And since they are building still towards Tron, with the Natty Tron over there, I choose to use Field of Ruin again. And yeah, indeed, we have drawn the Mystic Sanctuary, so the island was not thoughtless, it was just a gamble on putting them on Eldrazi Tron or not, and it didn't pay off. But they only have three mana here, and they have both their wastes. Usually, Eldrazi Tron only runs two copies, so the next Field of Ruin will be wasteland, kind of. But hey, just another Tron piece. And another Thought-Knot Seer. At this point, though, he has to pick Hour of Promise because we could grab Double Field of the Dead, and with this hand we could activate it, and there's no way Eldrazi Tron can grind through that. So, okay, Wrenn goes to one, that is not the big deal, but we have to deal with these Thought-Knots here somehow, and that's why I start to use Uro now, hopefully draw into Path to Exile number two, but not the case. Now we can use Field of Ruin again, because they have again two Tron pieces, so. And I want to prevent them from playing Reality Smasher, four mana Karn. Like, I think at this point you still have to Field of Ruin, even though I would rather use Growth Spiral, but what can you do? What can you do, guys? So, we can use the Wrenn Thickz and grab back the Field of Ruin here again for a fourth time. But I have chosen to not bring back any land drop because I was thinking that if he kills the Wrenn, we are only a few cards away from escaping Uro. But yeah, he has all of a sudden an Eldrazi Trample. Temple and place a Reality Smasher, and now he can attack us for 13. So in the end, we lose after 3-4 Field of Ruins. Maybe we draw a Path to Exile here with this Teferi Time Reveler, but yeah. Well, can't play this Omnath right now because the mana situation is awkward. We have too many basics. Yeah, I can pick up this Flooded Strand to make it possible, but I then can't trigger the landfall anymore, and at this point he will just trample over for the last point of damage, so yeah, feels awkward, but I realize here that we have lost, and all of that simply because I didn't use the first Field of Ruin to grab a basic Plains, but yeah, maybe I should have done this, but I was rather expecting Big Tron because I didn't see anything on turn 1 or 2. No Chalice, no Walking Ballista, no map. Yeah, I mean, map would be an indicator, but no, not this new Trine Book card for 2 mana, no Mind Stone, you know, all this typical Eldrazi Tron stuff. So, well, we lose an awkward game 1. Remember the top decks of our opponent because there will be salt down the line in the chat, calling us luck sacks and stuff like that. Yeah, Ethergust doesn't have text. Stony Silence is okay because it can stop Relic of Progenitus, it can stop Expedition Map, it can stop this weird tomb card that they play for 2 mana with the page counters that can scry or draw cards. And Wrenn in 6 is not the best as well as Lightning Bolt. bring out the spell snare because it's own yeah, it's okay nowadays, but think on the play we can rely on the mana leaks. And this hand is fine. We can fetch the Triumph on one. The Teemo Triumph, and then go with Forest and grab back the Misty to fix all of our colors. Here comes a tower into a map. And then I say the Cryptic top deck. Play the island out of reflex, and then I noticed, wait, that can't play Ren in 6, so here I make the misplay. Getting punished for that. Now I can't play the Ren in 6 out. I want to get the Uro going. Hope that we draw into another fetch land for the Cryptic, and we do, or a blue source in general. Yep. Well, he has Tron now. And because if we sit on three lands here still and only have Ren in 6, like Ren in 6 is, it's okay to grab lands back, but it's not the big game winner here against Eldrazi Tron, and we have the colors covered, all but white at this point. Yeah, well, and then he plays a Spyglass, and Ren in 6 is dead anyways, so it could have been in play still, but yeah. I made the misplay there, so Ren is dead. And here comes a Smasher, I think. At least we are at 22, so we have some time to draw a white source path to exile. And then we can dump the Ren in 6 to the Reality Smasher trigger. I still hold up Cryptic here because he doesn't have Cavern of Souls and I'm scared of Planeswalkers. And he could double spell, like he can go 4-mana Karn, 4-mana Karn. So with Cryptic first, we have at least a chance to draw another blue card, and then the graveyard is pretty quickly full with a Field of Ruin in our hand for the Uro. So, and if nothing happens, we can just bounce a land or something. But yeah, here comes Karn number one, so counter draw. Hope he doesn't have a good follow-up for 5 here. But he has, so I have to Force of Negation here and pitch the Teferi. On the bright side, our opponent has all the mana but is running out of cards, so let's get this party going and well, we still don't have a white source, but I can't get one here, and I really have to get this Uro going, I think. Okay, we are still missing a card anyway, so can also grab the plains here. So, yeah, we play Path to Exile on the Smasher and dump the Ren in 6, and then we can use it, but we can also just block with the wall, and he has played his land drop for the turn already, though it's a blast zone which can blow up the Ren in the Uro. But this way we only take one damage and we have enough cards in the graveyard. And him loading up the blast zone uses at least up his entire turn, and luckily we drew a Field of Ruin anyways, so yeah, let's go Uro, show them who's boss. And we have drawn a Cleansing Wildfire. This is interesting now, so we don't need the Field of Ruin right away. We can also just Cleansing Wildfire the blast zone away and keep the Field of Ruin for later. And still hold up Path to Exile, so here we go. This also redraws us a card, so it's a little bit more efficient in getting the cards or cycling through the deck. Whereas Field of Ruin, yeah, you just keep this. And drawing the mana leak here might be good. He doesn't have Tron anymore, so only 5 mana, so we can still mana leak a Karn here or something if we have to. And then we can also just put Cleansing Wildfire on top, maybe with a Mystic Sanctuary. Because at worst, it just cycles. Okay, he has a Cavern of Souls now, so. Well. Place it for Construct, because he wants to kill us here ASAP. But if he attacks, we just Path to Exile on the Walking Ballista instead and then see what he's doing. Doesn't attack, so let's aim for the Ballista and just put the path back into our hand with Mystic Sanctuary. So he has both of his basic lands in play, so most likely he will ping us with all three counters. Yep. There we go. Now we put the path back on top. And just attack into the Smasher. Start applying the pressure, and I think I kill the Cavern of Souls here. Okay, or still the tower because I fear Tron. With Path to Exile in hand, we have most creatures covered, and we have the Uro on the battlefield. So, okay. And a second Path to Exile. Okay, opponent at 14. So he has casted two 4-mana Karns. He still has a few Ugins in the deck. Here comes the Smasher. And yeah, for some reason I was thinking that MTGO asks you there if you want to discard to the ability. But instead, in this case, you just have to click on a card to discard it. And the button that appeared there means just no. So MTGO got me there. Because usually, whenever you do something, it asks you, do you want to do this, yes or no? But in this case, if you target the Reality Smasher, you just have to click immediately on the card you want to discard, or else it doesn't work. So I was a little bit too quick there, and therefore I wasted my Path to Exile. So that feels very bad. And opponent is deciding if he should cast six mana here into a possible counter spell, and here he chooses to play in Eugen. So he has all the bombs. Now he's empty-handed though, and the mana leak was still good. We draw more lands. And we draw more lands. Yeah, this is a downside I mentioned. Sometimes you just draw all the lands. So he has one top deck. Doesn't seem like a land because he would have played a land already. He needs all his lands to charge up the blast zone on three to kill this Uro, but then we can just escape it again. So let's see. Okay, he moves. I just wanted to skip ahead. And it's another Eugen. Talking about strong top decks, keep this in mind as well. And yeah, now if I would have had the second Path to Exile, then we could pressure the Eugen next turn. But now I have to Path to Exile this Reality Smasher first. This time I click immediately on the stem Ren and 6 to finally get it out of my hand here. And yeah, now he can create a 2-2 to block my Uro. So I put Cleansing Wildfire on top simply to redraw and get at least some value out of the redraw in killing this blast zone. Because else it will check my Uro. But yeah, this missed first path to exile on the Smasher makes this game now very close, all of a sudden. And what we have learned from the last video is how to differentiate the Uros if they stack. But I think they no longer stack after the last update, so. Anyways, yeah, here is the 2-2. I can't path to exile it now and kill the Eugen, so it will block Uro every turn and nets the opponent a card until I find another removal. And he also top decked another Planeswalker, and he has exactly the 3 mana. I still mana leak here so that he can't play anything this turn anymore, but. Oh my goodness. Keep all these crazy top decks in mind because the opponent will be very salty at the end of this video because we top deck so good. And then count also the lands we have in play right now. Anyways, opponent has now 2 planeswalkers. I have only one creature to attack. Okay, now he has 2 blockers. So he's playing around a path to exile. That is good. Instead, we are drawing lands anyways, but I still have to attack here because I need business. Yeah, and draw another land. So let's play this other Uro out. Keep the one with the damage marked. Draw the path to exile again. All right. Could path to exile the Sorcerer's Spyglass now, but can also wait on that. Maybe he draws some Thought Knots here or something. Drawing 2 lands there in a row really hurts. And the relic. Okay, just a redraw. And he had Thought Knots here as well. So, yeah, good top decks. Now he clears the way for his Karn Minus. Let's get rid of the TKS here. And we draw another Path to Exile. So, might as well use it here. Because we will lose it anyways to the TKS trigger. So. Might as well get it out of the way. I don't fetch the Triumph right now because at least we can cycle that. And I want to still leave some lands in the deck for the Omnath triggers and Field of the Dead, which we haven't drawn by now. Because Field of the Dead would be a way to pressure these Planeswalkers here. On the bright side, we have enough lands against the Sundering Titan, but that is still a headache now. Because we have used all of our Path to Exiles, so let's see. At least he is some land drops away from that. What will the Karn grab? He doesn't have any blockers here, so yeah, it's an Ensnaring Bridge, so we can no longer attack with the Uro. And he can cast that for 1 mana because of the static ability of the Eugen. Doesn't crack the relic yet. I think he should do that to deny us the redraw with the escape out of the with the Uro out of the graveyard. And yeah, okay, he does that. 2 cards in hand now. More Tron lands. And another TKS that doesn't have anything to do. Okay, a redraw at least. So the right one in this case is the new one, so we want to keep the old one, not lose it. And okay, Cleansing Wildfire is also a redraw, so we can finally get rid of the cavern. And Hour of Promise, so at least we get double Field of the Dead now. But we can't attack with it. At least we, yeah, but we still get two cards out of the deck, two lands at that, with that, and okay, the zombie army is here. Whenever he now has too much cards in hands, we can maybe one-shot him. I think I still leave the fetch land on the battlefield uncracked to have some targets for an Omnath, because Omnath would kill his entire board if we can gather some land drops. And also kill him, probably. So he has drawn a land drop at least. Welcome in the club. And another Karn activation. What will it be this time? Mystic Forge. Chalice of the Void. Alright. So with the static effect, he can put a Chalice on of the Void on 4 here, meaning that we can't bounce Ensnaring Bridge with a Cryptic and that we can't cast Omnath to clean up his Planeswalkers and his life totals probably, because then we don't have to attack anymore to win. Just need a few land drops. Yeah, so here comes the Chalice for 4. Now we need a Teferi Time Reveler. Like, if we can bounce this Ensnaring Bridge with a Teferi, we just kill him here. But instead, we draw another land drop. So I ship the turn back. I want to keep this land in hand for a turn where we maybe can bounce the Chalice instead and then have an Omnath. Follow up, like the Teferi Time Reveler into Omnath, and then we just play the land out of our hand and crack both, and then just kill him this way. But yeah, at this point it's just a stall here. Nothing happens. We just draw more lands. I didn't even count how much lands I have by now in play, and I still keep drawing on more lands. Here comes a Tech Edge, so he can kill one Field of the Dead. That should prompt me to fetch now, honestly. But at this point, I didn't really care. Like, I just wanted to draw some business finally, and creating more zombies. But fetching here also fills the graveyard for the Uro, so that would have given us another redraw. So I should have honestly fetched by now that I see that. He has a Stony Silence, he can blow that up with the Eugen, but at least then it doesn't create another token or something, so. And it shuts off his artifact redraws. So it's at least. It has at least some value and there's no land, but I needed a Teferi Time Reveler here. And he has a Dismember, right? So now he would be dead to an Omnath triple landfall trigger as well. If we then bounce the Chalice of the Void instead. Like, if we can't go through the ground, we can still burn him out. Now he has completed Tron again. Even after all this land destruction, he has Tron here. So he kills the Stony Silence and searches for a card now with infinite mana. And it's a Walking Ballista, so it seems like he doesn't have Mystic Forge or anything in the sideboard. Ballista now is very annoying because it can kill us behind the bridge. And we don't have Path to Exile anymore. But at least it will take some time. And okay, here comes the Teferi Time Reveler. So finally, we can do something. But now we have to attack because we don't have Omnath and I don't want to rely on a random redraw, so let's bounce the bridge instead. So we could have two zombies more by now. And yeah, okay. Draw another land drop. Hey. How can you draw so many lands? I mean, I would go to 27, but how high is the difference between 27 and 28 to draw so many lands by turn 15? So at this point, we just attack with everything and hope that Uro can redraw some stuff. Maybe another Time Reveler or an Omnath at least for the next Time Reveler. And I think I choose just send everything at him. Like at this point, keep your damn planeswalkers. You are at 4 life. You have to block everything I send at you. And now at least we have drawn an Force of Negation to counter the Ensnaring Bridge. So that Field of the Dead now is in real win condition all of a sudden. And him blocking with the spirit tokens means that he will draw more cards, and maybe he finds an Aulis Dust or something, so I might want to wait on these fetch lands. He can also sacrifice his Walking Ballista here and kill both zombies, but then the Teferi will survive. He could kill the Teferi with the Eugen, I think, but we shall see. Right. Kills the first zombie. It's also running out of time, but that will not be a factor in this match. Right. Now we can kill another zombie on. Okay, he chooses instead to kill the Teferi. So be it. And we go to 21. Okay. So he draws more stuff. Can redraw with the Uro in our graveyard because that could give us some more gas. Play the land for now because Chalice on 4 blocks Omnath anyways. Or just in case, like if he has the sweeper now, Aulis Dust, then at least we have enough cards in the graveyard to still escape Uro. And I want to use the Force rather on Ensnaring Bridge. So here comes another tower. Okay, Reality Smasher is not a big deal right now. Just another jump blocker. Go to 16. That's fine. And another 2-2. Okay. If we crack all four fetch lands here, we can still get him. If we just counter the Ensnaring Bridge. Another jump blocker, alright. And here comes the bridge, so force it. Hope he doesn't have anything now. Expedition map, fine, no one cares. He made his land drop already. And Blast Zone can't kill the zombies. And we still have three targets here, so I just create more zombies with all the lands we can grab here. I think we can leave the Triumph still in the deck, but at this point, just make more zombies. Growth Spiral is a redraw. ask, maybe we find the second time Reveler to bounce one of the blockers away. Should cast the Growth Spiral before attacking, but well, it would have been only a Dovin's Veto. I think we have more attacker than he has blocker at this point, so yeah. Could have played this better, but squeezed that out even with all the land drops in the world. And now we go into a game 3, and this will really highlight the power of Omnath. That's why I wanted to show this. Opponent has reconnected so that he doesn't drop out through MTG Olex. And I bring out a mountain here because I don't want to flood out as much, but what to bring in then? There are no good cards here. Guess Condemn was fine, should have brought that in. Maybe the Spell Snare is okay. But anyways, we keep a hand with Cleansing Wildfire on turn 2 on the draw. Into Teferi Time Reveler or Uro into Omnath. Opponent has a very good start. Has this tome that I talked about in the last game. So we start blowing up his acceleration here, bring him back to 2 mana. Then we use another Cleansing Wildfire, and we have a Field of Ruins, so we can do it all. Just have to slow him down a little bit. Here comes a Cavern of Souls, but he only has 3 mana right now. So, Expedition Map. We can use that to grab another Eldrazi Temple. Power of Promise is also nice, so yeah, I still blow up the Cavern of Souls here. Like, could use Uro to ramp up a little bit, but there is the Path to Exile I wanted. We can grab out a white source, or white green or something. Well, he has another Cavern of Souls. Comes the TKS, but at least now both of his basics are again on the battlefield, so he won't gain anything out of this Path to Exile. There we go. And hey, next turn. And we're missing a green source right now, unfortunately. What will he pick? This hand looks disgusting, but we are still missing the green source. Will he pick? Maybe Teferi Time Reveler, I don't know. Picks the Cryptic Command. Okay, that probably means like he has a Planeswalker in hand, and luckily we have drawn this Force of Negation. So this Field of Ruin is yeah, very good for us right now. Now we can force a Karn, pitch the Teferi at this point. Boom. And here comes the fetch land. So let's get the Omnath rolling. Do it. We have all the mana. Here it comes. Now he complains about insane. And I write back here like your last two games. Remember all the top decks and amount of good cards he had. Now it's time for us to have the good cards, like 2 Cleansing Wildfires into Omnath. Boom, okay. 4 life. Let's fetch again. I think a Breeding Pool here would be ideal. Yep. Yeah. Congratulations. Thank you. First Uro. Next land trigger. 4 damage to opponents. Second Uro. Come on. Give me more. Ah, damn it. All right. Well, the graveyard is full, so next turn we can escape Uro. We can use Hour of Promise to build a zombie army. Can also just hold up Cryptic plus Condemn. While opponent is still trying to hit more land drops over there. Because we have blown up a lot of them. He foils our fun and exiles our bin, but who cares at this point? Let's grab Double Field of the Dead and bring the zombies out. And get double Omnath trigger, and with the land in hand, of course, the triple. Yet again, put him down to 12, attack him down to 8, and yeah, now he rage quits. Yeah, so this is the match I wanted to show you. This was another 4-1. I won against Storm, I won against Belcher. This was the first round. First time playing against it, but it felt like just new Shoal Brand. Like, if you have the force, everything is fine and smooth. They can bring in more Blood Moons, or yeah, 4 Blood Moons after sideboard. Then you want Celestial Purge, and I mean, you have Ethergust anyways, so because it can also counter the rituals, so that matchup was not horrible. Lost a close match against Spirits, won against Storm, won against Sultai, because they couldn't deal with what our deck was doing. Like, we had Renin 6 into Teferi, into Jace, into, yeah, God knows what. We have so many bombs. We have Wail of Summer against their black payoff cards. Like, that's. I think I lost the second match, or the second game, only because I missed land drops, funny enough. You could see how many lands I did draw against Eldrazi, and exactly in this control mirror in the second game, I missed the third land drop for an eternity. So even this happens. So yeah, these Omnath into fetch land turns are really impressive. That was really, really cool. And I think what I did here, or what I would change to the stack, is I would cut the mountain out with the lightning bolt. Because if we remember the banned leaks, we don't really need Lightning Bolt in the main deck unless a lot of tribal decks will come back. But instead, I would put him some mass removal again. So the idea behind Fire Spout was that Omnath will survive when you Fire Spout, maybe off his ability or just in the following turn. It is also easier to cast than Anger of the Gods, and it can still kill most creatures out of the Vile decks if you draw it fast enough, but it's certainly no Supreme Verdict, so it can be countered, and I think you can play with your Omnath in a way that Supreme Verdict is still be good, and I mean, Omnath still replays itself. It replaces itself, so it's never really card disadvantage. So I don't know. What's also interesting with 4 mana now is that that Engineered Explosives becomes far better. And in the first turn, I can never see myself fetching a basic mountain. Like, I would always fetch a Triumph first, and I don't need the basic mountain against a Blood Moon deck. And I think another Field of Ruin deck would never target all of our red sources. I think they would keep at least one or two Field of Ruins for Field of the Dead. So it's very unlikely that they will cut us off entirely of red. And therefore, I think I don't need the basic mountain and go down to 25 lands. Sorry, 27 lands. And this leaves us two flex slots for, yeah, maybe again Ancient Explosives and Supreme Verdict. Just like with the banned field control of before. Yeah, that's where I'm at right now. Cleansing Wildfire was very good, especially against Eldrazi Tron, but I also expect it to be good against Big Tron. It should buy enough turns, especially in the early game, where you can maybe pivot yourself into a winning position. Renin 6 was very nice, also with Field of Ruin against Tron stuff. That is a nice synergy, and you are picking up maybe a Mystic Sanctuary that gets milled over, or more fetch lands to fix the colors that you need, or yeah, the triumphs if you cycle them for card advantage. All of this has upside. He's good against Noble Hierarch in general. He is good. He was good against the Dark Confidant out of the Sultai deck, so the ping has still value. Sometimes it can kill an opponent. Yeah, I think a few Ren and Six since we are playing red, why not? And yeah, that's mostly it. Okay. The last note, if you wonder why I play Gaea's Blessing, I have seen in the last events that mill crept up, and I have seen some Eldrazi Titans in sideboards, but I think Gaea's Blessing is a little bit better because if it gets milled over by yeah, the mill deck, you can still shuffle your graveyard back into your deck. If you draw it in between, you can also cast it. It will redraw it because yeah, it has also this draw card line stapled on it. And then you can use Mystic Sanctuary to put it back on top in response to a mill effect, and then you still shuffle your graveyard back into the deck. So thanks to Mystic Sanctuary, I think that Blessing is the better card. You can also bring it in against Dredge, because you can shuffle three of their cards out of the graveyard back into the deck, which is relevant against Ox or yeah, Dredgers themselves. So I think that Gaea's Blessing overall is a little bit better than an Eldrazi Titan. Sure, if you get to turn 5 with Omnath on the battlefield and a fetch land, you can hard cast a Kozilek or something. That can totally be the case. But I think that is a little bit too much win more. Like, you need the Omnath on the battlefield, you need a fetch land, and then you need an Eldrazi. And when you have Omnath with a fetch land, I think you're so far ahead, anyways, that I would rather play the Blessing for the situations against Dredge where you really need some early game interactions. So, yeah, that were my lines of thought to this deck. It's a lot of fun. I think at least Cleansing Wildfire is a nice boost here, and if you can afford this, give Omnath a shot. It was really impressive throughout the league. And the mana ability is really cool when combining it with Planeswalkers or Uro. So, yeah, thanks for watching. It was a small video, but hopefully you enjoyed it anyways. And the audio was hopefully also better or good or listenable. And yeah, till next time, guys. Take care. Bye bye.